Osiris.
This podcast is In the Loop, the Legion of Osiris podcasts. What does that mean? Osiris is a community of great music and culture podcasts. If you like this one, go check out others at osirispod.com and get in the loop. Osiris is partnered with Relics Magazine at relics.com.
Good measure. More than good measure. Measure of all things. Pleroma overflowing to our need. Fullness of glory. All that glory brings. Unguessed at blessing springing from each seed. Even the things within the world you make give more than all they have, for they are more than all they are. Gifts given for the sake of love, keep giving. Draw us to the core where love and giving come from, the rich source that wells within the fullness of the world, the reservoir, the never-spent resource, poured out in wounded love until it spilled even from your body on the cross. The heart's blood of our Maker, shed for us.
Warm breast, bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. Warm breast, bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. Warm breast, bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. Warm breast. Bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. Warm breast, bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. Warm breast, bright wings, Holy Ghost, brooding over everything. The world is charged with the grandeur of God. It will flame our light, shining from shoot for you. It gathers to a greatness like the ooze of oil crushed. Oh, why do men then now not wreck his rod? Generations have tried. And all is sealed with trade, cleared, smeared with toil.
I'm Bob Crawford, and welcome to RTN Theology. I think this is number 5. I'm here with Chris Breslin once again. Chris and I had the pleasure of interviewing Kate Bowler a couple months back. Actually, Chris brought me into the event. It was an amazing experience. And Chris, it's great to be with you again.
It's good to be with you too, Bob. I love getting you involved with all these dookies. It's really fun bringing you in on this, and I love getting other people excited about things that I'm excited about.
You know, my wife and I are Carolina fans. I'm a Jersey transplant. She's a lifelong Carolina fan. But Chris, if dookies were all like you, the world would be a much better place.
They're not.
So getting me involved, that's right. You got me involved with the Kate Bowler episode, and you got me involved with our guest today, Jeremy Begbie. I can't lie. This interview, this conversation that we all shared last week touched me so deeply, and I feel, you know, for years when I became a Christian, I wanted to live my faith in every nook and cranny of my life. I wanted it to be exposed, and I just didn't want to, you know, you go to church and sometimes you compartmentalize. This is where God is in my life, but God's not in my work, and God's not over here. God's not over here. Jeremy has helped me to understand, or maybe better figure out ways to embrace how God works through my work, and how I can embrace God and feel His presence in every aspect of my life. I know that's confusing. Chris, can you introduce us to Jeremy and maybe make sense out of what I just said?
Well, I got to know Jeremy while I was a student at Duke, and Jeremy's specialty is in theology and the arts, or theology through the arts. And he spends half of his year, normally the fall, in Cambridge, UK, teaching. Spends the other half in Durham at Duke. Has initiated the Duke initiatives in theology and arts, and they're just always working on really interesting, beautiful projects over there. One of the things I loved about being Jeremy's student is, I loved being his student, but one of the funny things about being his student is all of his classes always happen at 8:30 in the morning, and they always happen in a room with a piano. And I think when you get to listen to our conversation, you'll understand why. And I'll have you know that it was also at 8:30 in the morning, so that just must be his golden hour to talk. But like Bob was saying, I think Jeremy, one of the things that is so exciting about Jeremy's work is I feel like so often we have these intuitions, we don't know how to put words around them. We feel like we're encountering something that is beyond us or something divine. And a lot of what Jeremy's work is saying is, oh yeah, actually you are. God is speaking. God is working. You're encountering something beyond you, and here's how God is, here's who God is, and gives words and kind of some tools for us to understand that a little better and interact with it. And it's really exciting, graceful work, and I'm really looking forward to you being able to hear in on our conversation.
Yeah, I want to talk about so many of the things that we discussed in our conversation, but I think it's just best to let our listeners hear it all for themselves and take it all in. Thanks again, Chris. I can't wait to do this again.
Of course, anytime.
Well, hello, everyone. This is Bob Crawford. I'm joined once again by Chris Breslin. And we have a wonderful guest for you today, Jeremy Begbie. Jeremy, welcome to RTN Theology.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Jeremy has a specialty and an area of specialization that's very close to my heart. And it is I've personally been trying to figure out how music and my journey with Christ are connected, because I believe there's a mystery of faith and there's a mystery
music is very mysterious.
Yeah, very.
And there are more people that would tell you they love music than would say that they believe in God.
Yeah.
Probably. Or yes, that they're Christian or they believe in God. And Chris introduced me to you and your work, and a light bulb went off. And it was like, I was thunderstruck. I was like, ah, here it is. This is the missing connection that I've been trying to reach intellectually and spiritually. So, Chris, you and Jeremy have known each other for a little while. Maybe get us started in the interview.
Yeah, sure. I met Jeremy in my time at Duke Divinity School, and I had already been there, and Jeremy showed up, and they had started these amazing initiatives around theology and arts. And a lot of Jeremy's work, like you said, and I'm not even a musician, but definitely a music lover, really resonated and kind of affirmed a lot of intuitions that I didn't know really how to articulate around how I was feeling about what music and visual art and other of these forms interacted with my faith. Jeremy's work really opened that up for me. And so I really wanted you guys to meet was kind of my selfish motivation behind this. But I also want, if you're studying theology and the arts, you probably know or have read something by Jeremy Begbie or some of his colleagues. But I think a much larger crowd needs to know that someone like Jeremy Begbie exists, someone who's such a great theologian, but also a brilliant musician in his own right. Jeremy, I think any of these conversations, we have to start by kind of defining terms. And so if you would, will you help us kind of understand the difference between theology for the arts and theology through the arts?
Sure.
Yeah, please.
Well, I mean, first thing to say is that I'm on a journey, so I don't come with all the answers here. And it's been quite a long journey. When I started it in my early 20s, there was very little written on this in this area. And that was a great pity. There was a bit written on Christianity and the visual arts, from a kind of orthodox or evangelical perspective, but very little about Christianity and music or Christian faith and music. And I came to faith when I was 19 and wanted to be a musician up until then, professional, and I was starting professional training. But then suddenly this world of the gospel sort of flooded me, and I thought, well, what on earth, what does that mean for music from now on? And I hunted around. There's very little written in those days, but there's a heck of a lot more now, which is a good thing. But we're really only just beginning to explore those links in depth. That's the first thing to say. As far as theology is concerned, I'd say theology is, I think good definition is faith seeking understanding. Christian, it's the Christian faith. You're a Christian. If you presume it's Christian theology we're doing. How can we understand our faith more deeply? How can we think it through? And theology, Christian theology, is about thinking about and thinking with the Christian God, the God of Jesus. Now, what we're doing when we do what I call theology for the arts, we're beginning with those beliefs, with those basic core convictions of a Christian, and saying, what does that have to say to the world of music? So you might start with, well, what do Christians believe about creation or Jesus or the Holy Spirit or the last things, you know, what's going to happen in the end or beyond death or whatever. What does all that say to the way we make music and the way we hear music and process it? That's what I call theology for the arts, or in that case, music, but you could do that with any of the arts. What in the last 10 or 15 years I've been experimenting is what happens when you work the other way around. You're still a Christian. You're still working within a Christian framework. You're still oriented to the Bible and to the creeds of the Christian church. But then you're saying, what distinctive powers lie in the arts to help us access and understand those great realities more fully and more deeply? And what got me into that was I was teaching theology in Cambridge in England, in a seminary, but also in the university. And I found as a musician, I kept trying to understand things, but I was trying to understand them as a musician. And I found music had the powers to unlock a whole lot of things that were, for me and for many others, unnecessarily difficult. And at last, music can make some kind of sense of that. And I suppose the kind of classic example of it is the Trinity, which I think is best understood as a three-note chord, or analogous to a three-note chord. The problem with visual models of the Trinity is that we can't really combine threeness and oneness in the same space at the same time. So we tend to fall into a kind of three gods or a one bland god. If you're thinking musically, the way we hear three sounds in our oral perception, those sounds interpenetrate each other, they suffuse each other, and they resonate with each other. And suddenly you've got a whole different way of beginning to see how what the New Testament is saying about God could actually be true and could actually be conceivable. So that's an example of music for theology, or the arts for theology. And so I spent a lot of time, I tried to convince my slightly grumpy theologian friends that, hey, the arts really have something to give you and help you do your work better. So there's something serious, I think, at play here, not just a matter of finding handy illustrations.
Yeah, wonderful.
Well, I think this is a good place to kind of get started and just jump right in and dig
deep. Please do.
This is what people tell me, who my friends who err towards being Christians or aren't Christians, they say, I can't, yeah, Jesus was a great guy. He seemed like he was just a teacher and a great guy. But, you know, the incarnation and the Trinity, I just don't understand. I can't get my head around it. And it's hard. And if you study theology, like we all have from time to time, we've obviously wrestled, Christians have wrestled with articulating this for 2,000 years.
Yeah.
So we would be shortchanging our listeners if we did not ask you to sit down at the piano.
Okay, right.
And articulate and give us an example of this Trinitarian concept musically.
Sure, yeah, we'll do. let me say, first of all, that what I'm trying to do here is not so much start after the Bible and just talk about doctrine. I'm talking about these amazing texts, so that when John's Gospel we hear that the Father is in the Son and the Son is in the Father, that's the language that's hard, first of all, not the language of later doctrine, that something amazing is happening to the people who are writing the New Testament. They have to use this language. And remember, they're Jews. They're monotheists. They don't believe in three gods. We can never have that. But within this one God, in comes Jesus. And they're convinced that they're dealing with the very reality of God amongst them. So they begin to use incredibly daring language, which wants to say that this Jesus belongs to who God really is. So that's where the difficulties, I mean, also the glory starts, but I mean the difficulties start, not just in later doctrine. That's the first thing. So what I'm really trying to do is, how can I understand, how can music help me understand and celebrate and communicate this amazing thing happening in the New Testament text? And I do that, Yuri, by contrasting visual perception and oral perception. So visually speaking, if a painter has red, a pot of red paint and a pot of yellow paint, and they try to put the red and the yellow in the same space on the canvas, either the red's going to hide the yellow, or the yellow's going to hide the red, or if the paint's still wet, it's going to turn into orange. And what that reminds us is we can't see red and yellow as red and yellow in the same space at the same time. Objects in our visual perception occupy bounded locations, that is, places with edges. So that if you try to bring them together, they'll either merge or they'll hide each other. Mm-hmm. That's just the way we see the world. Now, if I play a note, on the piano, that note, what I'm hearing there and what your listeners are hearing and what you're hearing fills the whole of your heard space. It doesn't occupy a bounded location within your heard space. It's everywhere. Actually, although you hear it coming from the piano in front of you, it's actually filling the whole of your heard space. If I had another note, that second note is filling the same space, but you hear it as a different note. So those are undoubtedly two notes. If I add a third, that, and add it, to those, I'm getting three notes in the same heard space. Yet they don't merge into one note. So you actually have threeness and oneness there. But it goes better than that, of course, because what these notes are doing are resonating with each other. So that is making that a richer note, and that is making these two richer. They are giving away their sound to each other. So we're talking about a living, resonating reality. And that, I think, is a wonderful way of speaking of the Trinity. The problems, I think, with a lot of illustrations of the Trinity is they tend to be visual. And then you're just in problems from the start, because it's very hard to conceive oneness and threeness in the same space. But if you pick up, there's a guitar there in the corner, you just play a chord on the guitar, you're already experiencing what you call musical space. And musical space is very, very close to what the New Testament is telling us when it speaks about the Father in the Son in the Father. That's very hard to draw. It's very easy to hear. And if we could just think a bit more musically, now you're into all sorts of very interesting things. I mean, why is it that Christians have sung in harmony so often? Why? Because they're experiencing a kind of Trinitarian space without knowing it. I had a very interesting conversation with a distinguished composer in Cambridge once who came, he was an atheist, vigorous atheist, but very famous composer, and he came to see me because he had to give a talk on music and religion. He knew nothing about religion, but he knew a heck of a lot about music. And he interviewed me, and after about 5 minutes, I said, well, have you ever thought about the way that you hear sounds? I mean, you're a composer. You often have two or three notes sounding at the same time, and that they mix in your oral perception, but they never become just one. They retain their dignity and their distinctiveness as one. And then he said, so a bit like the Trinity. And so we started talking about the Trinity. This was about 10 minutes into the conversation with a complete atheist. We were talking about the Trinity and already taking them into what's there in the New Testament. It's right there in the New Testament. And that was an exciting moment. And then I thought, gosh, now this is happening. Now, if I'd tried to use all sorts of illustrations of tricycles and clover leaves and intersecting circles and all the things we naturally turn to, well, yeah, so. But here's something he loved. Here's something he knew. Yes, right. Here's something was exciting. Here's something that had positive connotations now and a whole different way of conceiving what Christianity was about began to open up for him. And he was delighted. He said he'd never thought about these things before. This was 40 years as a composer, never thought about that.
Music is something that mysteriously touches us from the moment we're born.
From the moment we're born. That's
and perhaps true. Before we're born.
Well, yeah. I mean, after all, they say the superstring theorists say that, you know, vibrations are built into the cosmos. There's lots of research to show that fetuses in the womb will respond to sounds. And if the mother sings or whatever, this makes a huge difference to later perception of music. So yes, before we're born, certainly. And children early on will very naturally respond to music. But a lot of people say, oh, I'm not musical. Actually, it's about, I think, between 1-2% of the population that can't respond in some way to music. It is virtually universal. And that's because it involves vibrating sounds that resonate with things like our heartbeats and our walking and all our, you know, bodily processes. So it's kind of built into the, hardwired into the way we are to enjoy and appreciate music. And I'm trying to say, what's the Christian or theological significance of that?
Yeah, I think this is a great way to segue into talking about one of your most recent books. I can't even keep up with all your publishing, but I have this Redeeming Transcendence in the Arts, Bearing Witness to the Triune God by Eerdmans that came out earlier this year. And a lot of the argument that you're making is similar to what we've been talking about in this book. If I'm getting you right here, trying to put our finger on what it means when we say that we experience something that is transcendent,
yeah,
that kind of beyond us, beyond our ability or capacity to explain, but something that we're no doubt experiencing, maybe even something that is core to us, but beyond our grasp. And I really love the way you were talking about your your friend in Cambridge. I don't know that you intended this. I know these were lectures that you gave at Calvin College. I don't know that you intended this to be kind of almost like an apologetic enterprise.
Interesting, yeah.
And by that I mean like a defense of the faith or kind of an explanation or a way into the faith. But it really reads that as me. I think especially...
That's encouraging. Thank you for that.
Especially with how kind of universal some of these impulses are for us.
That's right.
Yeah.
I think what I'm trying to do in that book is to say these impulses towards the transcendent or whatever, these rumors of God, all sorts of words for it, you know, experiences we have in front of the great mountain scene or the sunset or indeed a very powerful bit of music, people will naturally use divine language or theological, like they will that's what they pick off the shelf, so to speak.
Sure.
Or indeed the birth of a child or experience of great healing or whatever. And I want to take that very seriously. I really do believe the Holy Spirit can be at work in those very experiences. What I'm trying to do the book, however, is say, yes, let's speak of transcendence, but let's interpret those experiences and help people understand them more deeply by using a much richer biblical notion of transcendence than we often use. And the sad thing, very often when we speak about God's transcendence, we often just mean something fairly vague and nameless and fuzzy and, frankly, pretty dull. When you look at transcendence in the New Testament, it's a glorious concept, basically, and I think there are two parts to it, as I say in the book. The one is the notion of transcendence, as God is other than the world. God is not the world. But to say that God is other than the world is not to say God's not interested in it, precisely the opposite.
Yeah.
God's radically committed and involved and at work in the world, but God is still God and not one of us. So we need to hold that very firmly in place. That again comes out of the Trinity, because within God there is otherness. The Father is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father, though they are both divine. And it's out of that otherness within God that we find the root of God's otherness from the created world. And that's, of course, a relation of love. When I say God's committed to the world, God is other than the world, but he loves the world as other, in the way I hope that I love my wife as other. And my love for her is not a consuming love that makes her one of me. Mm-hmm. So real love, biblical covenant love, is always covenant love for the other as other. That's the first thing, transcendence. The other part of transcendence is uncontainability, that whatever we say, whatever we think, we can't contain God. And I said, yes, let's say that, but again, I want to give that a biblical, very biblical flavor by saying what's uncontainable is the goodness of God. We're not just talking about an abstract thing called infinity. What's uncontainable is God's endless, unconditional commitment to me. There's always more love for us. He never runs out of his goodness. You see what I'm saying? Now, with those concepts of transcendence, I think that then we can, as it were, run into the arts and find all sorts of rumors of that idea of transcendence. That's the transcendence we ought to be looking for.
Well, and I love that because I think it kind of disturbs or shatters our notion of something that is earthy and grounded in something that is transcendent, outside of us and ethereal, in the way I think good art does.
Precisely.
And you talk about, you know, outside of music, things like Rothko, as this kind of apophatic voice, meaning we don't want to say too much about God, and sometimes that is. Comes out of humility, sometimes its own sort of arrogance, but also like even more. I think this hits us at a really popular level. Like I even think of a lot of the music that Bob is involved with his band, the Avett Brothers. Like I think it resonates so much with so many people because it's this acoustic music that is really relatable in a lot of ways, but also kind of beyond. And so
at the same time,
that's right.
That's very good. You mentioned the apophatic thing there. That's a tradition which wants to stress the not saying, what you can't say of God. God is not the world. God is not finite. Whatever. And that's a very important tradition. What I say, or try to say to my students very often is, yeah, that's fine, but the apophatic is always dependent on what you can say.
That's right.
So when they say to me, Jeremy, God is infinitely beyond and unapproachable, right, how do you know that? And in what sense is he beyond? His love is supreme and uncontainable.
Sure.
His love is other than us. So you've always got to inflect that biblically. In other words, God has actually shown us who God is and what he's like in Jesus. And that then you discover what you can't say. Well, there you discover the danger of idolatry, of thinking that you can wrap God up in a box or in your hands and have him at your disposal. That's the big danger. That's when you have to keep silent. There's a kind of false humility. God is so great, I won't say anything. Well, that's ridiculous. Is that what Jesus said? I mean, come on. Well, I often did it. You know, Paul has a lovely, what was it in 2 Corinthians? Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift.
That's right.
He doesn't then say, and therefore I'm going to say nothing about it. It's inexpressible. Whatever I say will never be enough. But I'm going to give my life spreading this message. Right?
That's right. Yeah, well,
and you've got to hold both of those together somehow.
And even Jews that wouldn't pronounce the name of God were inside of this covenant elected.
But that's a very good point. Yeah, you don't pronounce the name of God, but that's precisely because God has revealed himself in a particular way as hey, you've got to be careful.
That's right.
There we go.
I think kind of on the theme of transcendence and areas that music can go that we can't go with our words.
Yes.
And with our emotional expressions. Music at funerals. Music at weddings.
Yeah.
Music that seems to accentuate, and it says things, like particularly in our sorrow.
Yeah.
And I think you do a great way of describing how musical techniques, right? Whether I went to a music conservatory, so I understand tension and release and appoggiaturas and all these things.
You're a learned man,
but I think our listeners, many of whom haven't gone to music conservatories or have not gotten their master's in theology, which I have not gotten my master's in theology, but I think they understand these concepts. They just don't have them defined for themselves.
That's a very good general point as well, Bob, because a lot of what I'm trying to do is just put words to what people intuitively know. In the case of music, Western music relies on patterns of tension and resolution. So we hear sounds like that and we expect or want that. We wouldn't expect a piece of music to end like that. There's a following note. There's a tension and then a resolution. Whole pieces are built around that basic tension and resolution. That's called harmonic tension and resolution. So, I don't know. That's Gershwin, and this is Home. We haven't yet got any tension, but then, of course, in the middle, he does this. Because we're going away, but then we're coming back home again. And that threefold pattern of home, away, and home again, or equilibrium, as I call it, then tension, and then resolution, that's how most Western music is actually built, on the small scale and on the very large scale.
Everything from Beethoven to the Grateful Dead.
Absolutely.
All points in between.
Grateful Dead, REM, U2, you name it. That's how it's going. All jazz, virtually all popular music, is going to work that way. So it's taking you on a journey, and it's bringing you home. Now, of course, it has massive resonances with the Bible. Parable of the Prodigal Son, creation, fall, redemption, the journey of Jesus from heaven down and exalted to the right hand of God. And so it's built into, if you think about it, this pattern is built into virtually every hymn or song we've ever sung. In all worship, it's there, even though we might not name it as such. And people feel it. So that if I leave you there, there's something just built inside you that wants that. So you understand this, but not with a certain kind of cognition. You understand it with your body, and you understand it emotionally and intuitively. Now, you can develop that in all sorts of ways, because one of the interesting things about music is that you can delay in all sorts of ways. So I can just resolve it straight away, or I can go... I can delay it again. Should do it again? Should I delay it again? And at last. So for about 30 seconds there, I was delaying that resolution. The Christian faith lives in the midst of delayed resolution. How long, O Lord? How long are we going to carry on in this world as it is, with so much suffering, so much delayed resolution, when God doesn't seem to be around? The Psalms are full of this. When nothing seems to be happening, when we've had these great promises of the new heaven and the new earth and justice and shalom and all these things, we have partial glimpses of that and real experiences of that in the present, but we look to the end. And a lot of being wise in the Christian faith is learning how to wait. Music teaches you how to wait. It's one of the things it does very well. You're not sitting there twiddling your thumbs thinking nothing's happening. When I delayed that, it's keeping you in the story. My sadness slightly is there's a great deal of Christian music that doesn't do that, where its resolutions come very predictably and very dully. And I think that says something sadly about a lot of our worship, which wants the feel-good experience the entire time. Well, life ain't like that. And most of the Psalms remind us of that. And the New Testament reminds us, you know, Romans 8, we wait patiently, creation groans. But yes, of course, there's a promise of glory at the end. If we can have more music that really expresses that and takes people into that experience, I think our worship could often be much richer. So there's some thoughts.
So as Christians, I think we've all experienced that with church. Of course, not at Chris's church.
Chris's church is entirely different. There the new heaven and the new earth breaks yes. in with a kind of unambiguous fullness.
But what? Is there is there a glory days of hymns?
Mm.
Is there a period, like I remember lamenting to someone a couple years ago who actually is much older than me and saying, but contemporary Christian music, it just doesn't do it for me.
Yeah.
Or it just feels very contrived in some ways at sometimes. And he says, man, they were saying that in 1913.
Yeah,
when I think about that music, that period of hymns, for me, that's when all the great ones were written
yeah.
in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Is there a period for
well,
you?
Well, I think we have to be careful of glory days. Sure, Watts, Wesley, the evangelical revival in England and America as well, generated vast numbers of extraordinary hymns. And the music was okay, but the words were even better. I think, generally. Some great tunes, of course, but the words have a kind of richness to them which has rarely been surpassed. So glory days might be overdoing it, but wonderful days nonetheless. Now, I think we just need to be a bit careful here, because what so-called contemporary worship music, we've also often got to remember, how is music being used in this context? Many contemporary worship songs are not telling a story of rich theology in the way that a Watts or Wesley was doing. Now, you may say, that's a shame, they ought to. Well, okay, but there's a time for heartfelt adoration. There's a time for a simple song that says the one thing to God or to each other. There's a time for that kind of direct devotion to Jesus that comes with a lot of contemporary worship music. So I say, there's a place for that, surely. And to critique that for not being a great hymn is, so, I think, a bit to miss the point, because in a lot of services or worship events, that's not what it's trying to do. Watts or Wesley, they were trying to teach, apart from anything else, they definitely saw a teaching role for the hymns in their day. And that's where you get very often a story, a narrative within a hymn, and a very definite theological flow. I think we need both of those, actually, and that's why I do try to support a lot of churches which bring those different traditions together. And then, of course, you've got to think musically as well. Yes, I think if the only diet we have is the very simple song, mm-hmm. 3 or 4 chords, fairly predictable resolutions, that may have its place. But if that's all you have, what are we saying? After all, most of the people go to these churches are going to films, right? Mm-hmm. Where the music is incredibly sophisticated in comparison, but they have no trouble with that. So it's not an elitist thing. It's not like saying, oh, we've all got to do classical music or something. And film composers know exactly how to grab you emotionally, how to keep you waiting, how to keep you in suspense, how to give you a sense of fulfillment and glory. I mean, think if you've seen the Dunkirk film, the way it comes together at the end in this overwhelming sense. Very transcendent, mm-hmm. actually, in all sorts. I mean, utterly uncontainable, the music there, I think. So we're all used to that. But funnily enough, when we come to worship very often, we just settle for a very narrow spectrum of musical techniques, that we're all able to be much more, how can I put it, much more sophisticated, or at least much more wide-ranging, have a much wider spectrum of music elsewhere. So those are just some reflections. I spent a lot of time in the contemporary worship music, and I spent a lot of time in the cathedral world as well, with the kind of what would be called traditional worship and choirs and all that. And I do think they need each other at the moment. I think they're deep critiques you can make of both of those traditions. And, of course, there are lots of other traditions in between.
Do you think of screens in worship? Screens.
The great advantage of screens is it keeps the head up. Mm-hmm. Hymn books, you sing into a hymn book. So I can tell without even looking. I mean, I could be blindfolded in a church. I can tell whether they're singing off a screen or singing in books, because it sounds much better singing off a screen. The danger of screens, of course, then it becomes a kind of idolatry. It's the idea that if the screen's not on, God can't arrive. It's the equivalent of a kind of certain kind of Catholicism. You know, if you don't light the candles, the Holy Spirit can't come in. So I'm okay with screens. It depends how they're used. I think there's a lot of PowerPoint worship that's incredibly dull, and it assumes you have to have images up the whole time and have to have dreamy background pictures and all that. Well, there are lots of ways of using. We need a lot more imagination. I think there are a lot of ways of using images in worship.
You've touched a little bit about some good habits for art reception, and hopefully our audience is kind of encouraged to open up our imaginations for how theological all of this is. I'd be curious if you would maybe give some of our listeners who, whether they're professionals or hobbyists or somewhere in between, art makers, some kind of encouragement or tips on art making if they're attempting towards something transcendent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Immersion in the scriptural text. There's always going to be more you can find there. So don't jump immediately to writers or theologians after them. Just immerse in the scriptural text with wise people that you trust, and you will discover all sorts of things. What I'm trying to do in the Redeeming Transcendence book is actually a number of places you probably just take a very well-known text and say, oh, hey, you know, something extraordinary is going on here, much more extraordinary than we thought. So, and the point of the book, in a way, is to say, look, folks, something revolutionary was happening, like a pressure cooker, something was bursting forth, and it's a lot stranger and more wonderful than we think, and it centers ultimately on a cross, so it's the ultimate strange thing. And if we can just inhabit that strangeness a bit more, so that's what I would say first of all to any Christian artist: they need to be people of prayer, need to be rooted in scripture, and then I would also be part of a community of a church, obviously, but also a community of artists who meet regularly, struggle together. A small group would do it. The idea, you know, the solo genius thing, we need to move away from that. It's not a Christian model at all. It's a romantic model.
I'd like to dig in on that little bit. The idea of the artist as the tortured, narcissistic, egotistical, self-destructive.
Oh my goodness, that's a lot.
Yet they produce, perhaps how Beethoven was. Or Jimi Hendrix, or, you know, like.
Sure.
It's a.
But lots of examples.
It's a type, right? It's a type. And how do we reconcile the beauty that they can, that God can create through them with the damaged vessel?
That's a great question. Well, I think, first of all, say, take Beethoven. He wasn't actually on his own. He was a lonely kind of person, but he was incredibly well versed in the tradition, in the musical tradition. He was deeply trained. He was apprenticed to people. He was always writing music for others. So he knew himself as part of many communities. He didn't shut himself away and just say, I'm going to do my own thing, you know, and be the great composer. And most composers, and be the same with singers as well, once you actually look at their lives, they're part of networks and communities. But we've built up this kind of myth of the composer or the artist or whatever that suggests the deepest resources they have of creativity lie within themselves. I don't think that's a Christian idea at all, frankly. Of course, there are things that each person can bring uniquely and individually. But the glory of the Christian faith is that God releases us from self-preoccupation, opens us out to others, and plants us, baptizes into communities of the unlike amongst people who are going to do all sorts of funny things to us and with us. And that includes as artists. So we have to be careful of the phrase, oh, God gave me this poem, or God gave me this song. I think that's, of course, that might happen. But I feel sometimes like saying, and have you tried it out on anybody yet? Have you asked anybody, you know, whether it's any good? John Betjeman, the English poet, had a nice thing when someone gave him a poem, and it said, with the little epithet, God gave me this poem. And he scrunched it up and put it in the waste paper basket and said, God gives, God takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. And So in other words, we need to test these things out. So the tortured artist thing, I think we need to get away from that. I don't think it's a good model, a good Christian model of creativity. Having said that, the element of truth is that making art of any sort is hard work. And sometimes I think if it comes too easily, we need to be slightly suspicious. But the same as anything, like a scientist or an inventor. I mean, great scientists will tell you it was months of experiments and, you know, cul-de-sacs and fruitless searches before they before the jewel emerged. And I write quite a bit of music and certainly practice a lot and all that. It's darn hard work. It's a lot of sweat. Mm-hmm. There's another thing. I'm just reflecting. Sorry, you can cut this if you want, but just reflecting that a lot of artists have been close to insane, and there's a lot written about that, about artistic creative and insanity. And I think that's because whatever the arts involve, they involve bringing things together you wouldn't normally bring together. I think it's what metaphor is all about. I think metaphor lies at the heart of most art. So you bring this whatever it is, element, could be a word, it could be an idea, whatever, and you're putting it where it might not normally belong, so that you can begin to see familiar things in unfamiliar ways. I mean, there's hundreds of examples from visual art when, you know, crosses are put in strange places and all that. I think that's the way that art typically works, and certainly in music it's happening all the time. Now, the problem with if you overplay that, as in, say, schizophrenia, is that you're making associations that will never make any sense. You're associating everything with everything, right? So that process, without any discipline, without any rootedness in reality, will lead to a kind of madness. And that's why I think myself that most artists have known what it's like to be a bit on the edge of that. If you think of, I'm not just thinking of perhaps even famous artists, because there are hundreds of examples of people who try to make connections and sometimes they just don't work and they're just silly.
Is it the listeners, the community of music lovers that idolize?
That's definitely right. The case. I was going to say that's a good point. I should have said that.
Feeds into that. It's absolutely a two way street, right?
Because I quite agree.
You have a lot of idolatry. We all do. We find a song that we love, and you identify with the artist. You put the poster up on your wall.
You know, you spend large sums of money to go and hear them. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's interesting that in the contemporary worship stream, there is a lot of idolatry of the worship leader. Sadly, I would have them invisible. I'd have them in the back of the church. I think that's where the performing thing can get really quite dangerous. We tend to think then, well, they're coming direct from God, so they're beyond criticism. And once you start going down that road, that is very dangerous. And of course, very often we thrust these on people who are young, relatively inexperienced, perhaps had little leadership experience, but can play the guitar beautifully and sing beautifully. We've got to be very careful there.
Well, we have a gentleman in the sound booth who, by the name of Jeff Crawford, and we'll edit this out if you want, Jeff. But it is hard to watch, or as a musician and someone who is on stage, and there is ego involved.
Yeah, of course.
Right, in what we do to some extent. When I go to church and I watch musicians performing worship music, it's hard to be like, okay, is this person performing?
Yeah, it's very hard to
know. Or are they guiding and channeling the worship? And Jeff Crawford does it like no one else.
I'm sure.
He's channeling the worship.
You know when it's really happening.
It's real.
It's fantastic.
But he's not rocking out.
Yep.
But he is, in a way, rocking out.
Of course, of course. He's giving his very best.
He's giving his best for God.
That's a great model, Bob. I think
it comes through. And that is a real challenge. Like, I couldn't imagine playing in a worship. I would love to play in a worship band, but it's like that would be the hardest thing for me.
I know. No, I quite agree. Just to flip to a very different musical setting. I was visiting a very wealthy Episcopal church not so long ago, and there was a brilliant choir and a great music director. But the choir was too invisible. It was caught up with pillars and and the sound wasn't getting out. And I was talking to him, I said, you know, you probably want, they were thinking of reordering that bit of the church, and well, it's fine. And I said, you really must be looking forward to that, because then you can be seen. And he said, no, the thing I absolutely want above all is to get this congregation singing. I thought, oh, wow. I don't often hear that. Mm. From choir directors, I often hear, the choir is not being heard properly. They're not being valued. They're not being paid enough. People don't realize how lucky they are. I mean, I do hear this very often. Mm-hmm. It was the first time I heard, wonderful thing, he said, my job is to get this congregation singing. And if we're going to reorder the church and make the choir more visible, it's in order that this congregation are going to sing better and really going to feel it very much more. Oh, that was wonderful.
Yeah, it sounds like both of you are kind of hinting, like I do a lot of worship planning, and it always seems like you run on this kind of spectrum of excellence on one pole and participation on the other, and those binaries maybe
very
need
hard.
Not exist, you know?
The key thing there, though, Chris, is just to be constantly alert to it. There isn't a simple fix.
Sure.
And it's very dangerous to say, oh, we've dealt with that a year ago. You never have.
That's right.
But that applies to lots of things. I mean, relations, sexual relations, the way you design your church, hundreds of things in church. You've just got to be alert to it.
That's right.
And alert to the danger of the performer who becomes the star, who becomes the magnet around which everything happens. If you're a certain kind of personality, pastors, many pastors have that problem, and they're idolized. And then they get into all sorts of trouble because no one's ever criticized them for 10 years or ever held them to account.
It also seems kind of predicated on a really scarce notion of resources, right?
Yeah, like exactly.
That's in order to make something excellent, we need to limit our voices and get the professionals up there.
Yep. I was preaching at a church Sunday before last, where they had an organist and a pianist playing together, and a cellist who hadn't been playing for more than about a year, I think. Fairly basic, just bass notes. The organist was 83. she loved playing the songs because she didn't worry about having to get the notes perfect the whole time, as on a sheet of music. She could actually improvise a bit, in other words. And had a choir. Now, if you took those to, the Carnegie Hall or tried, no, it was pretty basic. But given those resources of that time and that place, it was utterly glorious. And that congregation sang like their lives depended on it. Mm. And they adored these musicians and vice versa. And they were worshipping as one. So you're absolutely right. Excellent. We've got to be very careful of the excellence thing and what a real model of it. For me, that was excellent, you see. Sure. Now, you could say, could it be better? Yes. And it might be, well, they go to a choir workshop and they're standing. That's good. That's good. So it's not like you become complacent and say, oh, who cares? Doesn't matter as long as you feel it. No, no. No, but given the resources, there are times you've got to say, this is the very best that these people, given this time, and these people can manage. And can that help people worship God? Undoubtedly. I mean, if that wasn't worship with God, I'm in the wrong religion, and I don't know, you know.
Well, sure. And I think there's just an incredibly hopeful thing about that. And you talk about this several times as like a move of the Spirit to open out and create excess. Maybe that's why poetry is good for us, because there's always an excess of meaning. Yeah. But in you even use a beautiful poem in here about these created things giving more than
they are. Yeah. Yes. Malcom Guite is one of my favorite poets. He's an extraordinary
among writer. Other things, right?
Among many other things. you ought to get him to interview. He's absolutely, in fact, he's here in 3 weeks. Did you know that? Yeah.
Oh, I didn't.
And I include some of his poetry in that book. So that's a plug from Malcom Guite, G-U-I-T-E. But the point I make there is with poetry, as with all art, but poetry certainly, what all these metaphors and images and so are doing, they're creating kind of explosions of meaning, which may be very focused on a center. So they're not vague. They're very focused. But the resonances, the ripples of significance are potentially endless. That's why it can mean a variety of things to a variety of people. Now, I don't think it's an unlimited variety, sure, but it can be a kind of excess. And I think that's why poetry is so important to the Christian faith, because we live in a world that you can never exhaust, that you can never control. And ultimately, of course, that applies to God. God is the God of excess, the God of uncontainability. So uncontainability is built right in, I think, into the way the arts operate. And that's why we need, one of the reasons why we actually need them.
Well, it doesn't seem coincidental that, you know, Scripture refers to us as God's handiwork.
Handiwork, exactly.
These little instances of excess. And
well, you know, I'm looking at you now. You will always exceed anything that I can think or say about you. However much I get to know you, there's a dignity about a person that exceeds what we can ever say. And to love that person means respecting that. But the trouble is, if I want to express that, say, take my wife, might be slightly, I can describe her using physiology and physics and chemistry and biochemical reactions and electrical signals and all that, and those are true enough. Or I can write her a love sonnet, which will say certain things, but will set off resonances that are inexhaustible, and that will match, as it were, her inexhaustibility. I need both of those. That's why most scientists have an artistic interest of one sort or another, because they know what they're doing is very important, but limited. So our desire to control, to hold, to encompass with our words and thoughts, we've got to be very careful about. And the arts, why we need the arts, because it's a constant undermining or subversion of that idolatrous concern to grab and to hold. Yeah. I speak to lots of scientists who are absolutely transfixed by music, because it's something they really, you can explain a certain amount, but they know perhaps more than anything else in their lives, this is something that they just can't. And that very fact is very significant, it seems to me.
I wonder if there's a connection too. Like, I know for a fact, like writing a sonnet, there's rules to writing a sonnet, just like there's rules to voice leading, like writing music.
Absolutely.
So I wonder if there's a connection there.
That's very, if I may, he's moving in that way. I've talked about Malcom Guite, the poet. Most of his poetry is in sonnet form, which is very disciplined. I mean, it's extremely, and you have to be an apprentice to the tradition of sonnet writing to do it well. But once you're inside that, then the possibilities are endless. So we're not, when we talk about excess and abundance and all that, we're not talking about formless, undisciplined extravagance. No. No, it's the same way that God is not formless, God is Trinitarian. And God has interacted with the world in a particular way at in particular points. So that's a very important thing. And we got, of course, as artists, we have to recognize that as well. Every artist involves discipline training. However, and especially if you're improvising. Especially if you're improvising.
It takes me back to learning, I was like maybe music theory too, where you're learning voice leading and the rules like parallel fists and parallel, or no fists and parallel octaves and all that. And everybody's hemming and hawing and like, oh, why do I have to learn this? Yes. What's the point of this? But it is. You have to get inside the discipline to have the freedom. And I think it was Charlie Parker who said, learn everything and then forget it and go out there and play. Because
it's inside of you, you can
rip.
It's a great paradox. We have to submit ourselves to all sorts of disciplines in order to be free. In order to be free. It's part of the freedom. And the Christian faith is built on that. Of course it is. But if you jump for freedom straight away, it'll be chaos and very destructive.
I have one last question. Do you have a question, Chris? I just learned about theology and the arts a couple years ago from Chris. It led me to Fuller Theological Seminary, Cutter Callaway, ultimately to you. What's the next step in your research and your study? Where are you going? Where are you taking this next? And as a musician, as a bass player in a band, I play a role. I'm a member of a group. How can I better express myself as a Christian human being in my role playing bass?
Oh, my goodness. Well, to take the second, I think it's the sort of things I mentioned to Chris earlier about being part of communities that care, being a study group, a group of musicians in a similar place to you. That kind of mutual encouragement, mutual stimulation, hey, have you heard about, have you tried this or whatever, these are the things that expand our minds. You obviously read a lot. That's very important as well. So I would instantly take it into a kind of community perspective. Practice like mad. Know your craft. Don't skimp. We all go rusty. I think some people are very kind and they say, you know, you play the piano very naturally and all that. Well, it's very kind of them, but, you know, to do even a basic piece, that's another 10 hours. You know, even though I'd played it 20 times before, for me, you know, that kind of discipline. So that I would say as well. In answer to the first one, as far as I'm concerned, plans for the future. Well, Leslie Ubigin, the great missiologist, used to say, how'd you make God smile? You tell him your plans. So I'm always a little bit reluctant to that. But at the moment, I'm working on a big project called Theology, Modernity and the Arts, which is about how can the arts help us understand the theological dimensions of the last 500 years of Western culture. We tend to go to philosophy and sociology, whatever, we're going to understand, so to speak, what God was doing or where God was or wasn't as we look in the history of our culture. I'm saying let's look at the arts much more often, music, poetry, visual arts, or whatever. So that's a big 5-6 year project that I'm involved at the moment with, in the case of music, that musicologists, music theorists, theologians working together. We've just started one on the visual arts and there'll be one on literature to come. So that's the big project. Apart from that, I'm just going to see what sort of happens. I don't have more particular plans than that. I love my work at Duke and love my work in Cambridge. And we'll just see what God brings along.
Well, we're so lucky to have you here in our area. And
it's a great privilege.
So, so glad to meet you. Jeremy Begbie, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Well, that brings to a close another episode of RTN Theology. This episode was produced by Chris Breslin and Bob Crawford. We'd like to thank Jeff Crawford for recording our interview with Jeremy Begbie at Arbor Ridge Studios in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, We'd like to thank Alanna Boudreau for the use of her songs WBBW and The Lord is Coming off of her 2018 album Goodbye Stranger. And we'd like to thank Malcom Guite for the use of his poem Good Measure, Parable and Paradox, Sonnets on the Sayings of Jesus and Other Poems by Malcom Guite, Canterbury Press, 2016. And Jeremy Begbie for being such a wonderful guest and so generous with his time. Please check out all of his books, particularly his most recent, Redeeming Transcendence in the Arts, Bearing Witness to a Triune God. Until next time, this is Bob Crawford. Take care.
Will the Red Sea's closing in? There's no safety in our mighty oceans. Can you feel the driving wind? Behold the crashing waves. The Savior's on his way. The Lord is coming.
Beneath the weight of